So, yeah, we are live on YouTube too. So, welcome everybody to the second keynote of this ISMA 21. It's my pleasure to introduce Domenico Pratichizzo, full professor of haptics and robotics at University of Siena, Italy. He pioneered the field of wearability in haptics with an astonishing curriculum. He is the author of more than 500 publications, inventor of more than 20 patents. He is the president of the Eurohaptic Society and also editor-in-chief of IEEE Transaction on Haptics. He's also co-founder of two startups, Wert and Existo. Today, he will give a keynote speech on wearable haptics for virtual and augmented reality. As you know, this is a hot topic in our AR community because it is crucial to find the right equilibrium between the realism of the perception and the design constraint for wearability. This is valid for all kinds of devices. But now let me turn it over to Domenico to start us off. Thank you all very much for being here and keep enjoying a fantastic ISMA 21.
Thanks for inviting me to this wonderful keynote conference, actually. And it will be a pleasure for me to talk about our research and give an overview of the field of haptics in the virtual and augmented reality. Well, okay, so let me introduce. I'm working here, so I have a laboratory that is called CIRS Lab, and it stays between the University of Siena and the Istituto Italiano di Tecnologia in Genova. We are almost 15 people working in the field of haptics and robotic manipulation and teleoperation. Actually, you can see in all this screenshot of my screen, some frames of the activities that are in my lab. And you can see that in any of these frames, basically there is one hand. Why the hand? Because the hand is, you know, something very important for us to interact with the environment. And basically the hand is able to do mainly two things. One is to touch the environment, to touch the object, and the other one is to manipulate the object. So we are expert in our laboratory about technology for touch and technology for manipulation. In this talk, I will mainly focus on the concept of force feedback, haptic feedback for virtual reality and augmented reality. The force feedback was not did not appear in the research field for virtual reality and augmented reality, but entered in the area of the research because we wanted to telemanipulate robots, mainly for application in the ocean, underwater, or even in the space. Just to give you an idea, this is one of my applications of telerobotics when you are using a tactile feedback device, an active feedback, to feel what is measured here, okay? Well, these kind of technologies that are very familiar in robotics can certainly be used in virtual reality, augmented reality, and mixed reality. Why? Yeah, because basically what we want to do is to physically interact with the virtual environment, with the object that we have in front of us. You see that the divergence of our eyes when we see these three-dimensional shapes are very important in the near space to us. So it's very important to use three-dimensional convergence to understand the convergence of the sides of left and right eyes to have an idea of where the object is, especially when you want to reach something. So basically, the message that I want to deliver here is that if you have a three-dimensional object that is close to you, in reachable by you, then you want to touch, basically. You want to grasp it. And it is really, it can appear strange if you go close to the object and you don't feel anything. This is where haptics technology can come into the picture. So the first thing that we need to focus a little bit is the concept of kinesthetic and the concept of cutaneous perception. Basically, kinesthesia is something we can measure in the interaction with the perceive in the interaction with the environment by using the muscles and the tendons. Okay, so you have to imagine myself without the skin, and they can still touch and have an idea of the object that I am touching. but there is also something in my skin that is even very important. And we are talking here about cutaneous feedback, where we understand the thermal conductivity of the object that I touch, the texture, so the material of the object that I'm touching, and even in some sense, the shape, the local curvature. So according to this distinction between kinesthetic and cutaneous perception cues, we can distinguish between kinesthetic interfaces and cutaneous one. Just to give you an idea, this is a robot on the right that provides a force coming from a virtual object that reproduces exactly the force that a real object would apply on my finger, on the pen that I'm holding, if the object was there. So basically, robotics are applying through the haptic interfaces the forces that a virtual object will give. This is, you know, something that was existing in the field of optics since years. Actually, was one of the first one that was used to introduce the optics in our field. But as you can see, that kind of interaction is mainly mediated by a pen. So you have a pen, you have a surgical tool, you have a scalpel that you can use to interact with the environment. But it's very common that you interact with the whole fingers, no? When you hold the cup or when you grasp an object. And this was completely unclear how to do in our field before going towards wearable and cutaneous feedback. So my research group, together with a lot of colleagues all over the world, but especially we had a very important initiative in Europe to start thinking about multiple contact interaction. You see here, because here you had only one contact interaction with the environment. So if you want to go multiple contact, for example, in the upper part of the screen, you can see two kinesthetic devices, two robots that can interact with the thumb and the index and provide the haptic feedback of the thumb and the index to display the presence of a virtual object. Or you can use something wearable, like an exoskeleton that we developed here in Siena, under-actuated, easily adaptable to the human hand shape, to, you know, understand the shape and feel the consistency of an object. But actually, this is not, especially the exoskeleton, the upper part is not wearable. The lower part is wearable, but it's not wearable at the level of wearability that we want to reach. So the level of wearability that we want to reach in this, I want to talk about in this talk, is mainly the level of wearability that we can think about when we work, when we deal with our, armband, wristband, the things that we use for jogging, all the wearables that we see in our applications. So those are devices that whose weight is 10, 20, 30, 100 grams, not more. And an exoskeleton can weigh much more. So we want to go towards highly wearable haptics. So the first thing that you have to think about in order to have a principle of design for highly wearable haptics, you have to, I will quickly describe this picture. So on the left, the first box on the left represent, a typical robot, a kinematic chain that apply a blue force at your fingertip. And, there is the red force that goes on the ground. That's okay. Then you can, basically, this is a grounded optics. Then you can, you can wear this kinematic chain. And if you put the base of the kinematic chain on your forearm, this becomes an exoskeleton. Roughly, no? Basically, you have a kinematic chain that you wear on your body and you have an exoskeleton grounded on the forearm. And this is one of the first things that I really love to talk about anytime that I show this picture, is that look, typically the base where the exoskeleton is grounded should be large. Why should be large? Because the red force that you feel, look to the middle of this table. The red force that goes on the wrist should spread on a larger area because you don't want to feel the red force. And if you spread a force over a larger area, you have a small pressure at each part of the skin and you don't perceive it. So enlarging the base of the exoskeleton, you trick the brain and you let the human feel only the force at the fingertip, the one that you want to do. So if you want to go highly wearable, basically what you have to do is to move the base of the exoskeleton as close as possible to the point where you want to apply the force that is at your fingertip. And this is the first design that we did in Siena, where you have a very small robot with the 3 degrees of freedom that is grounded on the nail on a larger surface and apply forces at your fingertip by changing the shape, moving the platform at your fingertip, rotating through two angles, pan and tilt, and you also can squeeze the finger by squeezing the platform against the finger. So 3 degrees of freedom, pan and tilt, two angles for the platform, plus a squeezing force that you can apply to the fingertip. Basically, this is the tangent plane to the virtual sphere that you want to measure. One big problem here that I will not touch in this talk, but one of the main issues here is the track of the fingers. Of course, you are familiar with the Oculus device, HoloLens, all the helmets that we are using, that they typically track the wrist or something that you have in your hands, because you need to track your arm. But in this case, when you go at the fingertip level, you have to track your fingers, not only the wrist. And this is something really important in our field. With the additional problem that the motors that you are using can interfere with the accelerometer that are using the magnetic field, for example. By the way, so what we invented in 2013 is something that is really a paradigm shift. So basically, we went from a grounded device in optics to something highly wearable that are this device that you put at the fingertip. So in some sense, we did exactly the same paradigm shift that we had in auditory modality for the sound, where we went from the speakers in your rooms, that is, something that you can listen when you are in a sort of given workspace that are not wearable, you cannot walk around with this, to something that is wearable. Walkman in 1979 patented the idea of, for the first time, this headphone that was really a paradigm shift. So it was really a jump in technology, because moved the people from the room where there was the ground and speakers to outside. So you can listen, what happened to us with all these headphones. So in same sense, we went from grounded optics to wearable optics, like the grounded speaker to the headphone. What is missing? So there is something missing here. All people familiar with auditory modality knows that making speakers, so when you go from room speakers like this to headphone, you typically lose the bass, no? Lose some frequency, you lose something. And this is exactly what happens here. So in this kind of wearable device, basically we are stimulating the skin. So if you look to this device, now what are you stimulating? You are stimulating only the skin. So basically you are touching only the cutaneous part of the optics. You are not interfering, you are not interacting with the muscle skeleton part. So it's not a kinesthetic device, it's a cutaneous. So you lose many parts like the shape and other, and the weight and other things. But indeed, the wearable part going to the cutaneous is very important. This is an experiment done by Johansson, a very famous neuroscientist studying the hand in 2005. And he studied the role of the skin. For example, in this girl, healthy subject, they anesthetized the skin, and the task was just to grasp, to pick the object in this box and put them outside of the box. Without the skin, anesthetized skin, she was not able to do the task very easily. So you see here, she's not able to do the task because she has the skin anesthetized. What I want to show here that even if we go to the cutaneous level with our wearable, highly wearable device, still we are dealing with a lot of information we can take advantage from. In particular, what are the main things that we can work with in with cutaneous feedback? We can mainly do skin deformation, so we can show some pressure, we can show some texture with some voice coil, and we can also show some temperature with a thermal module. So by embedding in the fingertip device something that takes the skin indentation, the vibration for the skin, like when I feel a different texture, and even the thermal module, that in our case is a Peltier module, then we can show even the thermal conductance of the object. This is, for example, an experiment done in my laboratory with Guido Gioioso, where we were doing some experiment and feeling with these wearables the temperature. We were cooling the cane here, and we were feeling the cold temperature. You know, making cold is much more difficult than making warm sensation, because you can simply send current to a resistance. But when you want to do cold part, you have to do something very smart in order to be in a small packed area that you want to be wearable. Actually, there is one other thing that I would like to highlight in this case. When you go wearable, you can easily go multiple contact. So for example, this is an example where you can use five fingers at once to simulate the multiple contact interaction with a single object. This is exactly what happens when I hold a bottle, when I hold a cup, or when I grasp something. So this fingertip device with this platform idea is something that we can deal with in a multiple contact interaction. Well, all this idea, that is skin indentation, vibrations, and thermal module, become a startup that I had the honor to be co-founder of, and this is based on a patent that we have in our laboratory with Guido Gioioso and Giovanni Spagnoletti. And now this is a product. It's a product with three contact points, each thimble weighs 30 grams only, and the control unit weighs 100 grams. There is a very nice finger track. So basically the wrist is tracked by the tool that Oculus, for example, use, or even other technology can be used. So you can track the wrist with the technology of Oculus, and then we can track the fingers by using internal technology implemented in VR. So this device is compatible with Unity and Unreal Engine, and we are working and are making many contents available here. For example, this is an application where we can use this highly wearable device with the Oculus, where we use the Oculus device to track the wrist, and while we use the technology inside to write the finger. You can see we were interacting with the vials by perceiving the temperature of the vials. And here, for example, we were heating the liquid, and by touching the touch. So we also have the feedback that pushes on your finger to feel the keyboards. And we were, in this case, heating the liquid inside the water, and there we were feeling warmer bottle, and we put the bottle here, and we can now you can also grasp this kind of material that is cold, and you can also try to remove material with this device, and you can feel the vibration here. So we use the thermal module to feel all the temperature, plus the vibration module to feel the vibrations given to the removal material there. And in a while, I will show you also how we are able to feel keys of a lock key, for example, to open this box. You have to digit a sequence of digit, and you can do this, and you will feel the tap at your fingertip by using this this technology. Okay, one of the main issues of these devices is of wearable device is that when you simulate to grasp an object, your finger does not stop. No, because basically, if I am simulating to grasp a virtual ball, then as soon as you get close to the ball, you feel the contact perception. So you squeeze the finger, but there is no one that stops your hand from closing. We were studying that this is not a problem, especially if you are immersed in the context of the experiment. So you really stop when you feel the cutaneous part. But we are thinking also to add something more in terms of kinesthesia. So really to stop the, because when I grasp an object, before it's cutaneous, but then a certain point, there are the muscles that are stopped by the consistency of the of the bottle. So we are designing, of course, we don't want to use all the technologies like exoskeletons and grounded device to stop the fingers and the arm. Actually, the upper part of the robots stop the finger and the arm. The exoskeleton mounted on the wrist stops only the finger, while the hands keep going and you will never stop against the table. So basically the idea that we had is to add to the module of the cutaneous device only 1 degree of freedom. So it's just applying a torque only to a joint or articulation of the finger, not to do whole arm. For example, here you can see where there is this red arm, and this red arm is applying a torque to the angle theta, okay, force to the proximal and distal interphalangeal articulation, only with one motor. And we can have the local stop of my hand or at one joint that stops completely my hand. Another idea that we had, actually, that is we recently published, is that, so maybe I will explain you in this picture. So basically, what I want to say, especially if you have to, I don't know if you see my face, no? But if you see my face, I can show you with these two devices. So basically, when you, these are the old, some local device. So when you have this kind of device, so basically you grasp a sphere like here, of course your finger can move, but if you scale the motion and if you grasp the sphere when the finger touch each other, okay, even if in the virtual reality you have the hand open, okay, so then this self-contact can work like a local self-kinesthetic reaction without any need of kinesthetic feedback. So basically, you can use part of your body, that is the thumb for the index and the index for the thumb in this case, to stop the motion of your finger. While in the virtual reality, you show the end that is not completely closed, but you still hold a real, a virtual object. I don't know if this is clear. So basically, if you look to my hand, so this is the real hand, this is the virtual hand. So the real hand close to against each other and feels the consistency of the other part of the body, while the virtual one is like this one. Of course, I have the thimble and I don't feel the skin. So this is basically the idea. The real hand on the left does not close really, actually the real hand, while the virtual hand does not close and let the user feel the consistency of the object. Of course, the principle is based on a scaling velocity. So basically, the human hand should go faster than the virtual hand because the virtual hand should stop before the real contact. And we measured everything to which extent we can scale the two velocities between the real and the virtual hand. And inside with these perception studies, then we compared several subjects in experiment for pick and place. And we showed that this self-contact approach for kinesthetic feedback is really, really effective in terms of performance. So there is no comparison between visual feedback only and staying with the hand open and visual feedback plus the self-contact concept. Of course, you don't see your hand closing because you have the virtual, you have the helmet in your hand. Okay, now Regarding a taxonomy of Apix reality and virtuality, so there is a colleague of mine that is even co-editor-in-chief of the journal that I have the honor to lead, Sogmund Choi, who wrote a taxonomy of Apix mixed reality by inspired, of course, but from what people in visual feedback, in visual augmented virtual and mixed reality were doing. So we use, as there is a visual reality, we talk about haptic reality when you have real feedback from the real object. As you talk about, as people from Vision talk about virtual reality, virtual virtuality, okay, so basically synthetic visual feedback, visual virtuality, we talk about haptic virtuality. So when feedback comes from the virtual haptic display. Okay, and then of course there is something in the middle that mixes both the haptic reality and the haptic virtuality. Now I want, so up to here, I mean, all the examples that I was doing before, I was giving before for my lab, were mainly focused on haptic virtuality. So the haptic feedback was mainly synthetic and given by a wearable haptic display. Of course, multiple contact, very interesting, very realistic, with skin indentation, with a motor, with vibrations for textures, with the temperature for material conductance, you know, whatever you want, but combined between among these three main components, but it's still haptic virtuality. So we want to make something now that make us able to do mixed reality. So we want basically to mix haptic real feedback with haptic virtual feedback. As you are mixing, as people from Vision is mixing virtual reality and virtual virtuality. Of course, this scheme is takes on the x-axis the haptics, mixed reality, and on the y-axis the visual mixed reality. So you have all the blocks combining any stuff. I'm taking now into account the column in the middle because I will focus only on the haptics part. So I will talk about haptic mixed reality. So the first thing that you need to do, if you want to do haptic mixed reality, you should be able to perceive the real reality. You should be able to touch things. Because if you cannot touch real things, you cannot do the mixed reality. Now, for example, in Vision, you use the HoloLens, for example, because the HoloLens let you perceive the real environment. Plus, you add the layer of the virtual visual feedback. So in exactly the same approach, I want to show up here an idea where we make the real perception of the real reality perceivable up in with the haptic perception with a new device. Basically, the thimble, now consider a sort of parallelism, no? So the fingertip pulp in our case, you know, this part of the fingertip pulp is exactly like your eyes. So basically I'm assuming that I'm using the fingertip to touch the environment. So this is the like the pupilla, right? Where we get all the information. Of course, if you put a thimble on top on the fingertip pulp, you know, you don't perceive anything. You perceive the platform. You don't perceive the real object, okay? It's like having an oculus in front of your eyes because you don't see the real reality from an optic point of view. So basically the thimble form factor is not ideal for mixing virtual and real haptic reality. So the idea that we had was to move the device from the fingertip position to a ring level, okay? So closer to the palm in order to free the fingertip pulp as much as possible and to perceive the environment. Okay, so this is the device that we designed. Actually, this is also only for forces, but we were, of course, adding, as we did before, a thermal module and even a vibration module with technology available. But in terms of forces, basically what we have at the ring are two motors on the higher part of the finger, plus a band, a cable that goes through the finger. And here you have two motors. You see here on the left, when the two motors rotate in the opposite way, you squeeze, you reduce the length of the cable and you apply a normal force to the base of the finger. While when these two fingers rotate at the same direction, you apply a lateral force, a tangential force to your fingertip base. So we were able to apply two directional forces at the base of the ring. We are missing one, but so this is underactuated, but it's good enough to display forces. We can discuss later on what we are missing. For example, another reason that is important here that I would like to stress here, for example, I know that with this ring, I cannot apply forces along the finger, but only normal and tangential. This means that I have to realize the virtual engine taking care both of the visual and haptic part, taking into account this underactuation. So the virtual environment designer should know this underactuation in order to better design the VR, not to stress these forces. So in some sense, what I want to say here is important. So while the technology for visual feedback is already there, no? There are companies doing it, so we are studying new displays, but it's there. It's not, you know, it's already there. The technology that for haptic feedback is still ongoing. There is still a lot of research to be done. And the problem of underactuation is really strong because you have to move things. And the more things you want to move to apply forces, the more motors and actuators you have. And the more complex is the device, the less wearable it is. So underactuation is a must to be highly wearable and to let this device to be used. And the virtual reality engine designer should know what he cannot display because of the missing part in the haptic display. By the way, let me go with this presentation. Okay, so this is an important paper that we wrote a few years ago by showing that the ring was at that time the first device that was able to do mixed reality, augmented reality in haptics, because basically now you see in this screen, so you have your fingertip pulp bared, so without any platform on top of it, and you can perceive the real object, okay? While you have the ring on the index and on the thumb that will display the forces of a virtual object that is virtually placed on top of the real object. So you can see virtual object by vision and also by forces thanks to the ring. And this was possible because you were moving the actuation at the ring level, okay? You see here, you are grasping the object, but you also feel the weight of the virtual object on top of it by using the ring concept. This was something that I'm in love with, that was even taken by science that showed as one, this device as one of the first as the first device able to do force augmented reality in in a virtual mixed haptic, virtual augmented mixed haptic scenario. Of course, we were testing thimble against rings, a lot of performance measurement. The typical performance measurement that we do, sorry for the voice, is the pick and place. So we pick a virtual object and we place somewhere else. And all the performance in terms of time, in terms of applied forces were very similar to each other. So there were no big difference between the thimble and the ring. Because of course, if you feel the force of the ring, you are missing something, no? Because of the wearability, because you would like to feel the additional virtual object at the fingertip out, not the ring. But this is something that you is comfortable in terms of realism, is very realistic, and also in terms of performance is very good. So basically the idea is this one. So I consider for fingertip interaction, the thimble, the form factor for virtual reality, okay, and the ring, the form factor for augmented or mixed reality. So basically, so if you accept the idea of closing the eyes because of the virtual reality, you can also close the eyes of touch, that is the fingertip out with Thimpu. If you don't want to close your eyes to stop the vision, and you want to have something that lets you perceive the environment, you have to do the same for the touch, and you use the ring. So there is a sort of a form factor, ring, augmented reality, thimble, virtual reality. So we were doing applications. This was a game for HoloLens that was augmented by our device, and was really interesting in terms of perception. And of course, even the wearability is improved, because apart from the augmented reality and mixed reality, so when I have this thimble at my fingertip, I cannot type. And maybe when I'm doing some virtual reality, maybe I need to type and do something, right? And I don't want to unwear the thimble and write something for coding. So this is very simple. So with this kind of device, I can keep using my tools, because the perception is still free. I mean, I don't stop any perception of the human. Well, so we have a device for mixed reality, no? In virtual and real haptics, or mixed haptic reality, haptic mixed reality. Now, let me show a couple of experiments, a couple of examples where we use it. One is from my Claudio Pacchierotti and his colleagues in Rennes. Claudio was a former student of mine at PhD, and he's now in Rennes, and he's doing this very interesting application of mixed reality, where he's using basically tangible objects. So there is a real object that he's touching, plus he's using this mixed reality thimble device that we developed together when he was here in Siena, and he was using to superimpose a synthetic haptic signal to the real haptic signal in a mixed reality scenario to show, I don't know, for example, the pulse of the artery, or the compliance of the surface. So you can superimpose on a real object with a real haptic feedback something that is synthetic thanks to this technology. Well, we also are doing something interesting. This is not wearable, but it's portable. But we also have in my lab a wearable version of this. This is still WeArt, with the other device that they are working on is the haptic key. And basically, so you have a real surface that is a table, and thanks to this mouse, you can superimpose any kind of texture you want. Even changing the shape. For example, they have, for example, this is marble. And when you have marble, you can also change the conductance. So here, for example, we are changing the shape. So we are using the mobile platform at your fingertip to change the shape of the objects. So you feel these waves, these physical waves, or different patterns, different material. We have wood, we have marble, we have metal, we have plastic, many other applications that are rendered through the haptic vibration technology, plus the technology for thermal module. Okay, another thing that I would like to stress here is that we focused on something. This is a work by Yon Bissell, another colleague of mine in Berkeley, very, very interesting his research. And he's recently investigating material technology for haptics, because up to now, I showed technology that is based cable driven. Of course, the cable can be even a band, something like textile technology. Even the group from Pisa, colleague of us, Matteo Bianchi, is using this textile at the armband in order to produce something wearable, but always in terms of forces. But basically, in this work, Yon, this cell, was showing all the different technologies that can come up in the future, like soft material, pneumatic material, organic material, emerging nanomaterials, composite materials, fluid-driven elastic polymers, liquid crystal actuators, gel actuators, MEMS actuators, that is different from classical robotic technology, to show, to display new technologies that are able to stimulate the skin in a different and probably more realistic way we have now. If I can give you an example, I always love to give this example, but take it, you know, just like a rough example. Now in haptic technology, in my opinion, it's like we have a black and white display, no? Grayscale display, basically, no? Not as advanced like the 4K that we have in visual technology, in visual display technology. The change of technology, and probably in some sense, we reached some plateau, no? In terms of performance, even if we can still push things. Now probably it's time in our field to investigate new technology to see to which level we can break the limits of the current technology that we are using to see if we can do something more. But then I have to add another thing here. For example, many people tell me something about, you know, why you are considering the ring, why you are considering the thimble when you have, you know, basically when you interact with a bottle, you have the whole hand, right? So maybe it's not as realistic as touching with the finger, no? And then I, you know what the answer that I give to these guys, or in general, even to myself, I don't tell my, oh yes, I have this this one. Now, suppose in the visual feedback, suppose that I am completely taken by a movie that I'm really engaged, a series that I'm really engaged in, and I'm watching this movie on my screen. This is a small screen in a large field of view. So I also perceive this movie and the real reality, like I'm perceiving at the fingertip pulp, the haptic feedback plus with the hand is not perceiving anything. So basically, even this is a reduced space of my perception. If I'm very engaged by the context, the movie, I don't care about the rest. So what I want to say, even if I use a thimble, right? Like this one, if I am engaged by the context, if the context is so pregnant of significance that I want to deliver with this information, I don't care about the reduced space. Like I don't care watching the movie in a small screen like a mobile phone. Okay, so what I want to say is this one. So even if we reached sort of a plateau in terms of technology with the previous technologies, so I don't think that we combined enough energy among the community of VR, the community of the augmented reality, and the community of optics to create great synergistic contents that mixes haptics and visual and even auditory feedback, Well, and even smell, actually, the other component. Well, by the way, so here I'm focusing only on optics and visual feedback. Another thing in the last 5 minutes that I want to talk about is, I ended the part of, technologies for optic virtuality and technology for mixed reality. I want to show how these technologies can be really helpful for telepresence. Now, telepresence, I think that is something, telepresence, I'm in telepresence with you, no? And probably if I would have some haptic technology, could have been better, probably, no? So what I want to try to understand, if we can take out from this talk some ideas on telepresence. So we are recently working on, so this is the typical scenario of telepresence. So you have a human that is in a mixed reality scenario is perceiving what the robot on the other side is perceiving. So we change completely the paradigm, no? So we changed the paradigm and we said, no, we don't want to do human robot paradigm for telepresence. We want to do human-human paradigm for telepresence. This means that I want to use another human to help me in feeling something remotely. So for example, if I am a patient, okay, and you are a doctor on the other side of the screen and you want to do some televisit to me, you can talk with your doctor, you can talk to me, you can look to me, you can see, you know, what kind of shape I have and whatever, but you cannot touch me. No, you cannot touch me. So with technology that we are developing here in Siena, we are able to do the remote touch scenario. So basically we are able to touch something, so I can touch myself here. This is a simulated skin, and you on a remote part of the world, you can feel what I'm touching. And also, so basically we are adding a tactile layer to the audio visual tactile interaction. And there are many applications. You imagine the e-commerce, the telemedicine, the affective optics in case you want to help people during the COVID experience at the hospital. So many, many experiences we can work with. Dealing with emotions and interaction with something that really engages you. Of course, you don't only need to provide the feedback from the remote human to local human, but probably you also need to guide the human. Like this guy is guiding the robot, go here, go there, do something. We need to guide the humans, no? If the robot is substituted the human, the remote person should guide the human somewhere else. And we are here in Siena developing technology to guide the humans. For example, this human is guided along a trajectory thanks an apt feedback, exactly like the ones that I was showing before. He does not know anything about the trajectory he has to follow, but basically, if this is the remote human that I'm controlling, I can provide him the trajectory he has to follow in order to provide me some feedback. So I can send him somewhere, basically. No? And this is nice. This paradigm has been used, for example, for blind subject. For blind subject, we had this idea of tactile angel. So basically the idea is to use so the avatar of the human. So the voluntary guy is at home and the blind guy is walking in the town, but the virtual, the human is present close to the blind because he's taking the streaming from the camera mounted on the, you know, on the eyeglasses of the blind, and the remote human, the virtual, the voluntary on the right, has his hands on the forearm of the blind, telling him come, go left or go right, no? Thanks to the haptics technology. So basically, the volunteer at home, the volunteer should not go to the blind anymore. For example, if we are in Bari, where the experience, where the conference should have been in presence, if I am blind, then I want to go to the conference, I have to ask a voluntary guy there going there. But if I have this, human-human telepresence technology, I can ask the volunteer in Siena to guide me in Bari. Basically, this is the experience. This is the guy on the left that is going somewhere. These are the haptic feedback at the bracelet. This is the volunteer on the right. You see now, in a moment, you will see the index of the right hand showing him to go left. You see here the volunteer now, ta-ta. The signal arrives to the red optically, and it goes to the blind goes to left. They don't want to use earphone because they use the hearing to listen the environment. So they don't want to listen to any overlay on top of it. We were also using these techniques to do social jogging. So I can run with someone else that can be even an avatar trainer that helped me to run faster. What we showed is that if we apply apt feedback at the anklet with the same technology on the forearm, then basically the step synchronizes with the anklets. So I can run with an avatar where the avatar is not shown anymore in the display, but is actually shown on the legs because I feel ear or hair steps on my legs and I keep synchronizing. This is an experience, for example, these are two friends that are running together, even if they are remotely available. And even one of those can be an avatar, no? Can be a virtual teacher, a trainer that trains the volunteer by using this haptic technology. So there are accelerometers that measure the step, and the step is sent haptically to the remote user, to the remote friend that perceive at her legs, basically the same, sorry, this is a longer video, but basically both of them are running each other by talking and they are feeling each other at the legs, the steps. So we were simulating the running. This is a synchronization of the step. The last slide that I have is an application of this haptic feedback to have an avatar walker on your body, okay? So it's an avatar that is working with you, basically. This is very useful for people with a disorder in motor control that creates problems in walking, for example. This is a Parkinson subject. On the left, you see that the step is very irregular. Our avatar, haptic avatar in augmented reality, touch, is turned off. You see what happens when you turn on the avatar. When you turn on the avatar, you basically train the Parkinson guy to walk with you. And this avatar is much, much less invasive than having an helmet showing the avatar there. So what I want to say here is that we can, with this highly wearable technology, we can also invent new paradigms of interaction, human-human, mediated by some mixed reality that not necessarily uses the virtual display for vision, but maybe it uses exactly the same engine, dynamic engine that we were using for visual feedback only, okay? So we can project those engines to the haptics layer, and we can add an additional, you know, anytime that you add the new technology, new ideas can come into the picture and you can have more paradigms to play with. So I see for the future of haptics in virtual reality, for mixed reality, you know, very nice future for this integration, even if the technology is not as advanced as the visual display, but I think that they are there to be used in a very nice and efficient way for closer interaction, but even for remote interaction, for example, like working. I think that highly wearable optics will open new possibilities in virtual and mixed reality. And I also think that the paradigm of human-human telepresence will open new areas of research in augmented and mixed reality. This ends my talk. I would like to really thank my research group. Of course, I would have been able to do anything without them. So my big thank goes to them, my colleagues, and to you that are patient to listen to this long talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Domenico, for this very inspiring keynote. I mean, the first thing that I can think about is that in our community, a bunch of people, they do a lot of research about empathic enabled augmented reality. So I really believe that this, you know, haptic devices can increase this empathy among participants in this augmented mixed environment. So this can be definitely something to exploit more. Please use the Q&A text box if you want to ask something, Or you can also raise your hands so that we can promote you if you want just to speak live. Maybe in the meantime, I have a question for you because my background is on you know, industrial training using this environment. So we also find out that the lack of this haptic, or if you need to use the haptic using, for example, real tools, that can modify both the perception but also the performance of an operator while, for example, doing a training in VR or AR. So I think the future of this devices can be some, I don't know, like very thin gloves or something very, 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 very not invasive if you want to really not to change the performance in an industrial environment or while doing training. So what is your perception about the future of this device?
Okay, I'm trying to repeat your question because your voice was, I was able to listen only the 60% of what you said, but because of the network. So what I understood is if the haptic technology can interfere with the performance of the training in industrial environment or even some other environment. Antonello?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear, not very well, but I can hear you. So maybe I can just interpret. So I'm answering this question. So invasiveness.
I think Domenico has some problem. Yeah, I think it's Domenico network. Yeah. Probably we can ask him to reconnect. Yeah, let's just wait. I think we'll have a few more minutes because Domenico, Domenico, your mic, you're muted.
Sorry, I'm here back. I don't know, maybe there was a problem in my network. Can you, repeat, Antonello, the question?
Yeah, you catch the question very well.
Okay, the question. Yeah. Okay, so the haptic feedback for sure is improving the performance. You saw what happened to the Parkinsonian guy, no? That's an incredible performance improvement. And this can also be an improvement as any kind of auditory or visual feedback for when you train running or jogging, because you tend to synchronize with the augmented reality inputs that comes to your perception system. Okay, so there is a matter of synchronization, because for me it's disturbing to listen to, you know, to the augmented reality feedback plus my feedback. I get confused, so I prefer to synchronize. So synchronization is the reason why I follow the vibrations to my leg, okay, or I follow the avatar running. In industrial application, of course, if you want to have a complete suite that takes all the complete feedback, I don't think is the way to go. No, it's more to train the worker to have a few haptic hub points where they will be trained to receive feedback. For example, for the whole hand, I don't know, the fourth finger base. Here, or it can be the wrist, or it can be somewhere that does not disturb the action with the environment. As I showed before, when I see a movie, I don't care to look the movie in this small screen. At the same time, if I feel a feedback that is, for example, tells me in the industrial environment that some sense of awareness that everything is okay, or some signal of dangerous operation, like attention requirement. So these are all things that can be delivered in a small area with very nice feedback. For example, the temperature can be a signal of dangerous environment. So the warmer, the more dangerous is the environment I'm working with. So I need to be more careful, for example. And yes, of course, then it's a matter of interface design from this haptic hub and the environment. And the interface design should be designed in order to reduce the learning curve. Why? Why? Because the more you train to use some technology, the more you are, you get used and you cannot live without, basically, no? The easier is to learn, the easier is to live with and without the technology. Okay, so now we are targeting technology that are easy to use, interfaces that are easy to use, really because we want to build a world and environment where we can use these technologies without being overwhelmed by that kind of language. No, that we want to display.
Yeah, thank you. We have a question by Joe. He's asking, in the near term, how can we deliver haptic cues in AR, yet still allow the visual perception of our hands not to be significantly altered because of, you know, other components?
So this is a sort of... So I have even another answer for Joe, because that kind of thimble or ring can even work as visual marker, no? Sometimes you put the marker to do the tracking of the body, no? If you know the shape of the wearable that you are put on your body, then this can be a physical marker that you use to track your body. So you can help the marker, okay? You can help the tracking with this thimble or ring. But on the other side, I think that in mixed reality, you can relatively easily remove from the visual streaming the part of the thimble, because you know the CAD. If you know the CAD and you know the position, you can subtract with some simple technology and just make this part disappear in the mixed reality scenario. Or you can make it as a jewelry. So nice to see that you don't want to be without, no? Especially for rings.
Very good answer, I think.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other question? Okay. So I think Domenico will not be with us in Gathertown for meeting up later. So Domenico, can you just type on the chat your email if someone wants just to get in touch with you? And yes. Or I can do that. But anyway, we'll have the Discord channel open for further questions that I can have Domenico to monitor and to reply if needed. And so I think we have really to thank Domenico for this interesting speech, and so a virtual applause for you, and
thank you for inviting me.
Okay, just a communication. I have to remind the attendees that the next paper sessions will start back at 4 p.m. Italian time, of course. And you can now go to Gathertown and enjoy the poster, research demos, competition entries, and research lab. Just as preview, because all those will be live later today at 8 p.m. So see you in Gathertown and see you back for a paper session in less than 1 hour.